So I'll be speaking about decision-making about radiation therapy for DCIS. Just a little bit of background to start with. We know that the breast is comprised of ducts and lobules. And on the right here is a cross-section of a normal duct where you see epithelial cells that have are within what we call a basement membrane. And on the bottom, you see a duct DCIS where the cancer cells are within the duct, but they haven't crossed through the basement membrane. And as long as they're contained within the duct, we don't worry about the rest of the body or even the lymph nodes. Once they do cross into that, then it's called invasive cancer. And that's when we do think about those considerations. So when cancer cells are within the duct, DCIS is largely what we call a local issue or an issue that affects only the breast. So historically, DCIS was treated with mastectomy. And then over time, as invasive cancer began to be treated with lumpectomy or what we called excision, more and more patients then opt to get breast-conserving surgery for DCIS. And we can see that the rates of mastectomy declined in the mid-90s and the rates of breast-conserving surgery or lumpectomy increased during that time period. But when women retain their breast or most of their breast after lumpectomy, they then run a risk of having another breast event in the affected breast. And so there were a number of large randomized trials that looked at what is that risk and can radiation therapy decrease that risk. So here are the four large studies that were done initially. They were randomized. And despite the fact that they were done across different years and even different continents, their findings are actually very consistent. With excision alone or lumpectomy, there's about a 2% per year risk of having a new breast event. And with excision and radiation, that number decreased by about 50%. So radiation cut that number by half. Now, what were these second events? In purple here, we see the risk of invasive breast cancer. And in blue are the risks of having a recurrence of the DCIS. So in each case, whether or not one had had radiation, it's about 50-50. Second events can be invasive cancer or a recurrence of the DCIS. So we know consistently that radiation decreases the risk of having the second breast event. But what about survival? Does it increase the likelihood that you're going to live longer? So here is what we call a meta-analysis where they combined all the patients from the four prior studies. And on the x-axis here is time. And on the y-axis is breast cancer mortality or any death. And you can see one line here for breast conserving surgery alone and another line for breast conserving surgery plus radiation. And what's striking is that these lines are almost superimposable. So that radiation therapy, while it decreases the risk of recurrence, it doesn't affect how long you live, largely because even if you do have the second recurrence, and most always, it's treatable. So we know that radiation decreases recurrence but doesn't improve survival. So what are the downsides to radiation? Radiation is daily treatment of about 15 minutes, but you have to go to a radiation treatment facility. It's Monday through Friday for about 3.5 to 4 weeks. Although more recently, shorter regimens are also being used. There are some possible, acute side effects, which generally resolve a few weeks after you're done, mainly fatigue and skin irritation. But there are also some rare long-term side effects, such as cardiac toxicity for left-sided treatment, and we're getting better at avoiding the heart. So hopefully this is less and less common. Pneumonitis or cough or shortness of breath, which is treatable and also rare. And also the chance of having a malignancy or a cancer caused by the cancer, again, very rare, but not zero. Another consideration when thinking about radiation is, could it affect the ability to have breast preservation if you do happen to have a recurrence? So we know that radiation decreases the chance of having a breast recurrence, but if one does have a breast recurrence or a new breast cancer in a treated breast, because of limits of normal tissue tolerance, mastectomy has been the standard surgical option. We are getting more data about repeat radiation to a smaller portion of the breast, but that's still relatively new. In our current financial climate, costs of radiation therapy are hard to ignore, both in terms of, suicidal costs, as well as time away from work or time away from family that a patient needs to take. And that may vary depending on how far they live from a radiation treatment facility. So based on these benefits and sort of and costs of radiation therapy, would you offer radiation therapy to your patient? So the use of radiation did increase in the 80s and 90s, but it wasn't an even increase. So I like this slide here, even though it was taken from the UK and now is a number of years old, because it really does illustrate what's going on. On the x-axis here are different mammography centers. And on the y-axis are the percentage of patients who got breast-conserving surgery was treated with excision, who then went on to have radiation. So you see six mammography centers actually didn't have any of their patients go on to receive radiation, and about a comparable number having over 90% of their patients go on to receive radiation, and a whole range in between. So this really suggests that where your DCIS was diagnosed, which mammography center it was diagnosed at, plays a large part in determining whether or not you're going to get radiation, which means that there are regional patterns of care that may not be sensitive to patient preferences, but instead the regional preferences are dominating care, which is a marker of poor quality of care. And you see the same findings in the United States. So here is a SEER analysis that we did a number of years ago, looking at different SEER areas and then portion of patients with DCIS treated with breast-conserving surgery who then went on to get radiation therapy. And you see the whole range from areas that have fewer than 50% of their patients getting radiation to areas that have over 70% of their patients getting radiation. Importantly, when you distill down to even smaller, smaller geographic areas, you see even more striking geographic patterns. In San Jose, you have much higher rates of radiation use than the rest of California, and in Los Angeles, lower. So again, really suggesting that where you're getting your CIS diagnosis is determining whether or not you're gonna radiation therapy, not ideal in terms of listening to patients in terms of their preferences for radiation or not. So what can we do to make better? We have already alluded to this a number of times in the seminar today. Physicians do note decision-making about treatment for DCIS is very difficult for patients. And as Dr. King did mention, a number of studies have shown that DCIS patients overestimate their risk of recurrence, with over 25% believing that there's at least a moderate likelihood of DCIS spreading to other places in their body, which we know is not true. And if patients don't have accurate risk perception, then they may be making decisions that may not be the best in terms of relative to what the actual risk might be for them. So in an effort to try to improve upon this, we made a DCIS model, which we then translated into a tool. So the model which we made used the existing data for patients who need to make the decision now. And as we've seen, they were fairly consistent, the data regarding rates of local recurrence. We use this model to fully delineate the nature and magnitude of the trade-offs associated both with DCIS and with tamoxifen you heard Dr. King speak about earlier. So with this model, we looked at six treatment scenarios: lumpectomy alone, lumpectomy with radiation, lumpectomy with tamoxifen, lumpectomy with radiation and tamoxifen, mastectomy, and mastectomy with breast reconstruction. And the outcomes we looked at in our current version were 10-year outcomes. So both risk of having an invasive cancer in the 10 years, a DCIS recurrence in the 10 years, but also dying from breast cancer or dying from other causes. So our current version of this decision tool is housed as part of the educational materials for the COMET study, which is a large pragmatic trial of surgery versus active surveillance for low-risk DCIS. And our current decision support tool is designed such that patients can navigate it directly. And we have outcomes described in 100 patient icon arrays. We separately present outcomes for low-risk DCIS, high-risk DCIS, or outcomes if a patient doesn't know what their DCIS risk status might be. And we have an optional pre- and post-tool survey so that we can get an idea for how effective this tool is. And this tool is housed at, and you can get to this tool at cisoptions.org. So I'm just going to take you there now. Okay, so you can go to cisoptions.org and click on the decision support tool. This gives you some information here about what risk estimates are, why a tool might be helpful, and what kind of questions to keep in mind while using the tool. So here is the optional pre-survey where we actually ask patients what the likelihood of dying might be after DCIS so that we get an idea for what their knowledge might be. In this case, we'll just skip the survey. And then you have the opportunity to input in one's age as well as the grade of the DCIS. So for purposes of illustration, I'm gonna put in 66 for the age, and I will say that this patient has low to or intermediate grade DCIS. Now, here is our description of all the different treatment options that we display outcomes for: lumpectomy and radiation. And it describes some of the side effects as well so that patients can know what these treatments entail. And on the bottom, we also talk about our active surveillance, although that is not modeled in our tool. We don't have the same level of evidence right now about outcomes following active surveillance. So on the next slide, you can click what treatments you're interested in. So let's say I'm interested in lumpectomy and radiation, and mastectomy, and that's where I want to compare the treatments. And this is an intro screen to the outcomes. So here is what we see for patients who have lumpectomy alone within the next 10 years. In light blue, we see that about 70 women out of 100 will have no event in that breast. About 6 over the next 10 years, if they have lumpectomy alone, will develop an invasive cancer. About 6 will have a future DCIS in the same breast. And importantly, 17 women will die from causes other than breast cancer, which we think is important to help keep these decisions in perspective, and one might die from breast cancer. Here are the outcomes when you look at lumpectomy and radiation. So radiation really does increase the likelihood you won't have a future breast event in the next 10 years, with many fewer women developing an invasive cancer or a DCIS in the same breast, but the same numbers of women dying of breast cancer or from other causes. And finally, here are the outcomes for after mastectomy. So again, as you no longer retain the breast, the risk of having a new breast event on that side is essentially zero. And again, the risks of dying are about the same. So finally, we provide some questions for patients to ask as they work their way through these different treatments, as well as questions that they can take to their provider so that they have some idea of what things they should be considering as they talk with their surgeon or their providers as to which treatment option is best for them. So I will take you back to, okay. So actually we have done some analysis on what the effect of this decision tool might be. We found that among users on the tool, median time spent was 6 minutes, and that 76.5% of tool users thought that tool was very helpful or helpful in terms of making a treatment decision for DCIS. Importantly, we actually found that the tool improved knowledge about DCIS. So about 60% of the patients here in this dark blue bar graph here, very low for the chance of dying from DCIS before they went through the tool. That increased to over 70% when they went through the tool, and that was statistically significant. So it really does suggest that the tool can be a method in which to help educate patients about what their outcomes might be. So we do have a lot of different directions that we'd love to take the tool, one of which would be doing a randomized trial to see, does tool increase knowledge amongst all different types of patients, or does it really change what treatment patients are going to pick? And does it improve the quality of their decisions? Are they happier with the decisions that they've made? We'd love to look at, should this tool be targeted to patients, to their surgeons, or both? And finally, really look at risk communication. Is this 100% person icon array effective across all audiences, or are there other ways to communicate risk that might be better for certain subgroups? So in conclusion, I'd like to thank the many people who were involved in making the tool, as well as the many people who were involved in funding for the tool. And I will then turn the reins back over to Dr. Mittendorf. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Dr. Punglia, for that excellent presentation and the online demonstration of the tool. For those of you that were listening, that is also the same tool that I highlighted in the break. So if you wrote that down earlier, then you have it. A couple of questions that are coming in, I've answered a couple of them, but let me throw a couple of these to you. So can you please discuss the optimal timing of radiation after lumpectomy? And is there a time when it's too late or ineffective?
No, that's a great question. And we hear that a lot. So, you know, it's not possible to do a randomized trial saying to a patient, you're going to get radiation 1 month after surgery, and you're going to get radiation 4 months after surgery. So we've looked at this in a retrospective way, but obviously patients who have surgery late can be different from patients who have surgery early. Our best indication is that, you know, starting radiation 6 weeks or 2 months after surgery seems to be the most effective. And there might be a slight decline in the efficacy of radiation after that time point. And I always tell my patients that, you know, the side effects from radiation are going to be the side effects. So we want to give you the radiation when we know it has the maximum benefit. So after 4 months, that's where I generally draw my line. But we usually like to get patients started within 2 months of surgery.
Okay, excellent. And a question that was sent in advance, can radiation have an adverse effect on lungs?
So that's a great question. Because of the way the breast is shaped, a little piece of lung does often get included in the treatment field. But because we don't have to treat the nodes and can angle the beams, that piece of lung is very, very small. So the likelihood that it affects the lungs is very small. I would say 1% or less. And I had a professional oboe player whom I treated a number of years ago who said, okay, maybe for normal patients, they might not notice this difference, but would she notice it? And in fact, she did not. So it's very rare that it would affect the lungs, but a little portion of the lung is in the field.
Okay, thank you. And then we have a question, what about the decision RT test? This particular patient heard about this test too late and had already started treatment. How are you using this information when you're counseling women on radiation therapy? And do you want to share with the audience that who may not be familiar with the test? Do you want to tell them what it is?
Yeah, so this is a test that looks at markers, individual tumor markers to stratify a patient's risk. So you send the a DCIS off and you get a score. And the score gives you an idea of what your recurrence risk might be, both invasive and DCIS over the next 10 years. And importantly, they will also give you a score as to what they think the benefit of radiation might be. My issue with the test is I don't feel that it's such that I discount other factors in terms of recurrence risk. So I will still look at a patient's age. I will still look at their grade. And once I have those factors, I don't know that the test really sways me that much. I think of it as maybe one more piece of information, but we do have ways to, model that risk out if patients are interested in knowing what that might be. But right now, I don't routinely recommend that test for my patients.
Thank you. Yeah, so just to be clear for everyone, so there are actually two tests on the market by two different companies where your individual DCS can be sent to them, and they run their own special, one is using stains, additional stains, like what Dr. Harrison showed you this morning. The other is looking at RNA expression. They have their own individual formulas, but both tests give us a risk score back. So an estimate of what that of what a patient's individual risk of recurrence may be. So they're all they're estimates, right? They're not absolutes, but they try to help us with that individualized risk prediction, which is, you know, where we really want to go. We want to identify those women who likely have that low risk disease and may not need all the additional therapies versus those patients that have higher risk disease and may benefit from more intensive therapy. All of, you know, they both tests have their strengths and their weaknesses. And so we really don't use those tests in a vacuum. As Dr. Punglia said, we consider those tests in the context of the other things that we know that impact risk, such as patient age and so forth. But they can be helpful as tools, right? As you're thinking about your options and walking through what may make more sense for you. The one last question before we wrap up here. For an older woman, so 75, 80-year-old patient, does any change in, should an older patient consider radiation following surgery, given that it won't change life expectancy?
Yeah, no, I think that's an important question. So for my older patients, I, again, walk them through what the risks of recurrence are, and that, you know, their chance of having other medical issues at that age also increases. So you need to put that in perspective. Often I will tell them if, you know, it really does depend on how inconvenient radiation is for them. If they live really close by, they might want to do it for the recurrence benefit. But if they don't, especially if they have other medical issues, I don't think it's a have to do kind of treatment.
Great. Thank you. So one last question. I'm gonna throw this one to Dr. Mittendorf because I don't know the answer. Maybe she does. Given all the side effects of radiation and endocrine therapy, is there any research being done on less invasive therapy such as cryoablation or hyperthermia?
Yeah, so that's an area of interest more so for invasive cancers. And I think I'd refer us back to Dr. Harrison's talk that kicked off this forum. As she talked about DCIS, the way I describe it tends to be a little bit more insidious in that it's moving along the ducts and you can have skip lesions versus invasive cancer where it's a more well-defined mass. So I think right now where the research is with respect to cryoablation, meaning making an ice ball out of it to kill the tumor cells, or hyperthermia, which is using the opposite, using heat, we're still trying to do studies to see if that may be effective when there's a well-defined mass that we can target. I think it would be a little bit of a stretch at this point to consider something like that for DCIS.
Great. Well, with that, I think we will wrap up. I want to, again, thank all of our wonderful speakers this morning and all of our attendees who stayed with us. If you're in Boston, it is a rainy morning, so you didn't miss anything outside. But we really appreciate all the questions. And as Dr. Mittendorf said, we will be we have written these down and their answers, and we'll be sharing them in our newsletters in the coming months. So thank you very much for joining us.